Well, I hope indeed that you've drawn closer to the one we've been talking about and singing about and praying to this morning. We are starting a new series in the book of Ephesians. So, of course, I would start that off by talking about dog tags. Makes logical sense. You see, dog tags are issued to our soldiers in the military. They are not just so that soldiers can have a personalized piece of jewelry with their uniforms. It's not a fashion statement. The purpose of dog tags is so that if a soldier is severely injured or killed in battle, they can be identified. Now, let that sink in for a minute. The whole purpose of having that hanging around your neck is so you can be identified when you're dead. Now, one tag, and I've got a set right here, there's two tags on there. One is usually hung around the neck, and the other one has got a little shorter loop of chain so that they can hang that on your toe in the coroner's office. It's kind of sobering, isn't it, to think about. Dog tags, the prototypes of them, from what I've gathered, began in the Civil War. So soldiers, I mean, the carnage was bad and identifying the soldiers was hard. But by the time of World War I, they had become a regulation in many of the branches. And so the set that I have here today belongs to Casey, and I want to thank him for his service to our nation. They have very important and personal information on them, such as a name, an ID number that the Department of Defense gives you, a blood type, and your religious preference. In fact, since y'all can't really see Casey's, I've got a picture of his that's up close and personal where you can read it. So, I think we need to pray for him, you know. That's a strange religious preference, but no, I appreciate Casey being a good sport because he controls the slides back there. He could have done anything he wanted. So that's good. But think about the significance of dog tags. Think about this. They're standard issue for all soldiers, right? If you're in the military, but they're very personal for every soldier. And when they hang those around their neck, it's both a personal commitment and a hope. First off, the whole purpose of having them is that this is a personal commitment to doing whatever it takes to defend our nation, even if it means dying. It's a sobering thing to hang dog tags around your neck. But there's also a hope. As they hang close to your heart, there's a hope that if you do have to make the ultimate sacrifice, that you won't be forgotten and you'll be reconnected with your family. You won't be an unknown. So if you think about what dog tags communicate, they identify the individual in the midst of a larger organization, right? Something bigger than themselves. The dog tag says they're part of the military, but it also says their name and ID number, which always connects them back to their family, ultimately. The dog tag mentions their blood type in case of a bad injury, they need a transfusion. And the dog tag identifies their worldview with their religious preference. Now, 2,000 years ago, Paul the Apostle wrote a letter to some Christians in Ephesus, which is a port city located in what's modern-day Turkey. All right, it's in a place that you can go see the ruins today if you want to. But Paul ministered in that city for about 3 years. And about 7, 8-ish years later, he's writing a letter to them, encouraging them, because his time in Ephesus taught him one thing. The Christians there were not on a playground, they were on a battleground. And he found it necessary in this letter to remind them of who they are in the midst of that battle, because their personal identity spoke to the fact that they were also part of something bigger than themselves. Their dog tags are stamped all over this letter. And by extension, that means yours is too, if you're a believer in Christ. Their dog tags in this letter say they're part of the kingdom. Their dog tags connect them to the family, their church. Their dog tags remind them of their blood type, namely the shed blood of Jesus Christ that redeemed them and made them who they are. Their dog tag identifies their worldview in the midst of a very hostile, polytheistic culture and city. Savannah, polytheistic is a SAT word that means you believe in many religions. There you go. All right. Savannah gets her SAT lesson very regularly. All right. We just want her to do good. That's all. This city was a melting pot of ethnicities, and it was a port city that connected the West and the East. And you had as many as 50-plus gods and goddesses worshipped in this city. But there was one goddess in particular that stood apart, and her name was Artemis. This is a picture of her temple, or reconstruction of her temple. We have the ruins of it. But Artemis, her temple was so grand that one of the ancient writers called it one of the seven wonders of the world. It was an amazing place, and Artemis was so prominent in Ephesus that they would hold regular processions through the city on a regular basis, honoring her and looking for her protection over the city. Artemis was a Greek goddess, all right? The Greeks had their gods and goddesses. Her counterpart in the Roman thinking was Diana. All right. And they were Artemis or Diana, whichever one, was the goddess of she was considered a virgin. She was a huntress. She hunted. She was also related to midwives and birth and those kinds of things. Wonder Woman is sort of based on Artemis. Okay. Wonder Woman's character is partly based on Artemis and Diana, and also some mid-20th century feminist ideas, among some other things that we won't go into, all right? Because if you read the biography of the creator of it, there's a lot of different directions they pulled from. But basically, that really powerful, unstoppable woman, that was Artemis. She was associated with birth and death, all right? Again, the goddess that would help midwives and women give birth. That was the leading cause of death among women in the Roman world. And so they would seek her protection. She controlled animal spirits. And in fact, you can't see it in this picture very closely, but on her skirt, she had all these animals. Okay, now this is a reproduction of her statue that would have been in the temple. And we've dug up a lot of figurines of this all over the place. They had her little figurines everywhere. But animal spirits were considered to cause harm and problems in your life, okay? She was also considered all-powerful and even called the Savior in Ephesus. Did you think that anybody besides Jesus was ever called a Savior? A lot of them were. Their God, their goddess, they thought she was the Savior. Now, there are, it's hard to see possibly, but in this picture, there are many objects on the front of her, bulbous objects, okay? Now, scholars have for a long time thought that represented many breasts to represent fertility, that she was a nursing mom and fertility. But that is just, that's what some scholars think, but that's just absolutely silly, because where are you going to buy a bra like that? No. See, more research has been done, and what we believe is really that those represent are bags called kershaw. Kershaws are bags, leather bags that were filled with magical substances and used as talismans to ward off evil. Okay. Now I know that all sounds weird to you, right? That's just strange. But she has so many on the front of her. It shows this picture of she can ward off any evil or calamity. That's the idea they had behind their goddess. And this is important for us to know if you're going to understand Paul's letter to the Ephesians. Artemis was associated, because of those bags, those kershaw, she was associated with magic. And there's a lot of practice of magic in ancient Ephesus. In Acts 19, we even see how that magic came to the forefront and had a foothold in the city, and it even had a foothold in the church that Paul planted. They were practicing sorcery and magic in the church. No. Yeah. Now, how many of you have your little magic kits you got off Amazon at home? You need to throw that away. It's of the devil. I'm kidding. We actually have a couple of those. I think we threw a couple away when we moved. That's not the kind of magic we're talking about. We're not talking about pulling rabbits out of hats, okay? This is invoking Artemis to put a curse on somebody you don't like. This is invoking Artemis and trusting her with your children and your life and everything in between. This is worshiping something else and then trying to use magic to force her to bend to your will. Magic in the ancient world was all about people making gods do something for them, hoping that it would ward off evil and get their way. All right, so Paul's ministry had to contend with this because when he came to town and he started healing people, they thought, ooh, magic. This must be magic. And Paul had to clarify that for them. And in fact, there's, and you can read it in Acts 19, when he did that, there was a problem that exposed all this magic in the church, and they brought together all their books of magic, and they burned them to get rid of the idolatry in their life. And Luke talks about in Acts how expensive those writings were and how much money went up in smoke that day. All right, but the more important thing is all the idolatry that went up in smoke. And so it's a neat story. You can look at it in Acts 19. But see, what had happened, what we see in that story is there was Jewish healers that were using pagan magic. And so what that's called is syncretism. Syncretism is when you want to blend worldviews together, even if they contradict. It's when you want to take a little bit of this and a little bit of that, and you want to mix it together in your own little hodgepodge worldview of your own. Okay? And this is untenable. It just doesn't work. When you start blending worldviews, there's going to be problems. And honestly, it makes sharing the gospel in a culture that embraces syncretism, it makes sharing the gospel so difficult. And let me tell you why. You see, in all other cultures like Ephesus, and it still goes on around the world. In Africa, they do this. There's a lot of syncretism going on. What they do is they say, well, you know what? I'm going to appeal to whatever God or spiritual force I got to get what I need. So I'm going to, you know what? You tell me about Jesus. Oh, yeah, okay, that's great. I'm going to believe in Jesus too. And I'm going to call on him to see if he can help me with this problem. And while I'm calling on him, I might go over here and call on Artemis too, see if she can help me with this problem. And oh, I'll talk to Apollo too. I'll talk to any God who's willing to help me through this situation. That's what syncretism looks like, and that's what they were doing. In our American society, people do the same thing. No, you may not be calling out to Artemis and worshiping Wonder Woman, or you might, I don't know. But in our culture, what people will do is they'll take Christ and they'll just kind of add him to the pantheon of gods. We'll take a little bit of Jesus and mix it with our views on the world that we get from Oprah or from a science class or whatever it may be. We'll mix animism and Christ together. We'll mix it together, and really the biggest way you see it happen is in universalism, where somebody says, you know what, it doesn't matter what you really believe as long as you're sincere. First off, that's hogwash. Secondly, the person who usually says that, in my experience, is the least sincere of all. It matters what you believe. Ask the people who died at Osama bin Laden's hand. He was very sincere. In some cases, all we found were dog tags. It matters what you believe. It's not an opinion. It's not just, that's where I think I am today. You see, what you believe should be a conviction that holds you, not an opinion you hold. It matters what you believe. You see, we like universalism. You know what universalism is? It's everybody goes to heaven. As long as you're sincere and good, you might add that little caveat. I shared this before, but with a young man, Michael, that we shared the gospel with down in New Orleans, and that was a team effort there. It took all week and took several people, but he finally made a decision for Jesus. But you know what he told me the first conversation? He said, well, I'm a Christian, but I'm a universalist. No, you're not. No, you're not. Okay, that's like me saying, well, I'm Jeff, but I'm Nathan. Those are mutually exclusive. That doesn't work, okay? You know what I told him? You see, what universalism is, he's saying, well, everybody goes to heaven. It's all okay. It's all good. Let me tell you something. I looked at him and I said, Michael, do you understand something? As a Christian, you say you believe that Jesus came and died on a cross for your sins, right? Yeah. I said, well, that was the stupidest thing he could have ever done if everybody goes to heaven automatically. Why would he do that? This man literally stepped back like that when I said it. I've never thought of that before. And I finally was able to say to him in the conversation, I said, Michael, the reason why you want to be a universalist is because you want to feel better about your sin. If there's no absolute truth, if there's no ultimate authority that you've got to answer to, then you feel better about your sin. It really doesn't matter. As long as I'm being mostly good, that's all that matters, right? But that's how syncretism looks in our culture. And syncretism simply adds Jesus to the pantheon of gods. And Americans may simply add Jesus to their pantheon of self-esteem. He is seated right next to yoga, vacation, karma, motivational quotes, and psychology. But Paul made it clear to the Ephesians in this letter, and he's making it clear to us right now, Jesus did not leave us with that option. He's either God or he's not. You don't get to season your other beliefs with him. Now, in Ephesians, as we get into it, there's another issue that's going on. Not only does he have to deal with all this syncretism, but he's got division in the church because you've got Jews and Gentiles in the church and they don't get along. And Paul's got to talk about this. And what you're going to find is the very place that Paul starts is their identity. Who are they? What's on the dog tags? Because that's what's going to address the disunity. That's what's going to address the magic and all that mess, the syncretism. And what you're going to find in this book, there are three main themes you're going to see repeated. There's other themes, but these are three main ones. You're going to see that identity is a main theme. Lifestyle is a main theme. And spiritual warfare is a main theme. So, I'm going to read the first two verses of this book. And yes, this whole sermon is based on these first two verses, okay? We're going to read Ephesians chapter 1, starting in verse 1. And if you would, stand in the honor of hearing God's word. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and are faithful in Christ Jesus, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Our Father, I do pray that you are indeed the Father of all in this room. Lord Jesus, I pray you are the Lord of all who are in this room, but if there's anyone who doesn't know you and have that authentic relationship, I pray they would before they leave here today. Help us to know who we are in you. Help us to know your power to transform our lives. Help us get on the battleground to your glory and honor. And it's in your name we pray it. Amen. You may be seated. All right, so right here in the greeting, we see how important identity really is. Paul identifies himself by his name. Isn't that good? I'm Paul. That's helpful. But think about that name. See, Paul, his dog tags had changed. His identity had changed. You see, Saul had become Paul. Paul the Apostle used to be Saul, the Hebrew of Hebrews. His name was Saul, and he was a Pharisee that knew the Mosaic law. Saul was against Christians when they first started preaching the word. He started persecuting the church. And he was on his way to arrest some Christians in Damascus when Jesus stopped him in his tracks. As they're traveling during the middle of the day, the story goes, as you can find it in Scripture, that Paul is stopped by a bright light that's brighter than the sun. Everyone in his group saw the light as well, he says. But then he heard a voice, and it's the voice of the Lord. And he said, Saul, why are you persecuting me? In the conversation that follows, Jesus reveals himself to Saul. And from that encounter, Saul became a believer. And from that encounter, Saul became Paul. And from that encounter, Paul's identity was forever changed. Let me ask you something. Have you had an encounter with the living Jesus? I'm not talking about the Jesus of your opinion. I'm not talking about the Jesus the way you'd prefer him. I'm talking about the Jesus of Scripture. I'm talking about the Jesus of history. Understand, Saul was very convinced he was doing the right thing until he got blinded by the truth and he had to have his sight removed for a while. And then the truth gave him his sight back. The truth being Jesus Christ, the way, the truth, and the life. See, Paul had a real encounter, an authentic encounter with Christ. Not a cultural one, not a I grew up in church one, I'm a member of this such and such church, or no, a real encounter with the Lord. Have you had it? Now, so not only did Saul's name change, he became Paul, and his identity changed, but so did his purpose. Paul's purpose changed as well. Paul identifies himself as an apostle of Christ Jesus. The word apostle means sent one. One who is sent. When he was Saul, he was sent to destroy the church. Now, as Paul, he is sent to build the church. His whole purpose in life radically changed because of his encounter with Jesus Christ. Let me ask you something. What's your purpose? What are you living each day for? What are you living each week for? Is it just to be comfortable? Is it just to keep working and make enough just to pay the next bill? In Christ, your purpose becomes something so much bigger. You're part of something eternal. There's something we're called to do. And Paul realized that his job was to build the church. That was his purpose, was to proclaim the graceful gospel of Jesus Christ. What do you think your purpose is? I would dare say it's not too different than Paul's. Not only did his name change, not only did his identity change, not only did his purpose change, but so did his worldview. His worldview changed as well. You see, Saul was a Pharisee, and he lived by strict adherence to the Mosaic law. And his adherence and his hope was that by doing that, he would earn God's favor and he would maintain it. But as a follower of Christ, Paul understood that he had to live by God's grace alone. It was by God's mercy and grace that he was who he was. You see, you can't earn God's favor. Our sinful nature gets in the way. Even when we do something good, our pride and selfishness taints it. Because you'll do something good for somebody and you have that thought, man, I'm pretty good. I really did good today. You have that thought. You have that thought of, I really hope they appreciate that. You do something good and you're just waiting for the pat on the back and the recognition. Sometimes it doesn't come and we get bitter about that. Those are examples of how our pride and our selfishness even sneaks in when we're doing something good. And that's not to even speak about the stuff we just go out and do wrong, okay? I mean, we just go out and sin. And by the way, Satan didn't make you do it. He doesn't have to. Our sinful nature is all it takes. Let me tell you something. If Satan isn't messing with you, you're not a threat. Think about that one for a minute. All right? Our sinful nature taints it all. And see, what Paul realized was that he had to be completely dependent on God's mercy and grace and strength to live out this new purpose God had given him. We often work, as Americans, we work from this assumption that we deserve heaven. We work from that assumption. But we cannot forget or ignore the fact that our sin is real and our sin really deserves eternal punishment because we have sinned against the eternal, holy, God who created us. We have committed high treason against our king. We deserve punishment for that. And Paul understood that he was lost without Christ because of that. But then he found out about Christ and he learned that, yes, we deserve punishment, but Jesus Christ came and died on a cross to take that punishment for you and for me and for Paul. Christ was his only hope. Christ was his only source of his new identity. Christ was his only source of his new purpose. Christ was his only source of strength to live all this out. Let me ask you something. Does Christ shape your identity? Does he shape your purpose? Does he shape your worldview? Or is he just among the other gods you listen to on a daily basis? Paul not only talks about his identity, but he also talks about the Christians in Ephesus and their identity in this greeting. Just as Paul was set apart to build a church, the Christians at Ephesus were also set apart. In fact, he called them saints, which means literally holy ones. That means they are set apart. This ties back to the Old Testament when God's people were set apart by his mercy and grace for his purpose. Okay, this is an Old Testament idea in Paul's mind. He's kind of got this as a former Pharisee. And understand what saints are not. Please hear me. Let me tell you what saints are not. They are not super spiritual people who have earned the title saint because of their own personal merit. Saints are not super spiritual people who have earned the title saint because of personal merit. That's not what the word means. They are saints. They are set apart. They are made holy by God's grace alone. And that's it. In fact, there are people who, if anything that they've done, they've realized, like Paul, how much they need that grace. Saints see their needs more than people who aren't saints. They're set apart by God's great love. And the people who are saints are those who have surrendered to that love. They've surrendered to that grace. And let me tell you, as you read that and you say, to the saints who are in Ephesus, it better challenge you to say, am I in that group? Am I a saint? Am I set apart by God's grace alone? Am I set apart by God's? Have I received that love and that grace that comes from Christ alone? And then Paul calls them not only saints, but faithful in Christ Jesus. Faithful. The word faithful here denotes a reliability. All right? It's you're reliable, right? Well, how so? He says faithful in Christ Jesus, and he puts Christ first to emphasize Jesus' role and title as Messiah, the promised one of God who was going to come and save and redeem us all, and he in fact came and did that. And so Paul is calling on that and emphasizing that he is the Messiah. And what he's saying is, you know what, I'm calling you saints who are faithful. You are living a lifestyle faithful to the Messiah. You are walking a reliably Christian life. A reliably Christian life. And Paul is going to give them more direction in this letter on how to improve on that. He's going to give us that direction on how to improve on that. And of course, their lifestyle does not earn them salvation and eternal life. Their lifestyle is a response to that salvation and eternal life. Don't get the cart before the horse on this one. Listen, there is expected Christian behavior from Christians, not so that you earn your salvation, but because you've already received your salvation, it therefore should lead to some kind of difference in your life. And if it isn't, then you probably don't got it. That's the bottom line. So let me ask you something. Do you have that salvation and eternal life in Christ Jesus? If you don't, your next step today is to get it. It's a gift being offered to you, and God saying, here it is, take it. I want you to be free. I want you to have eternal life. I want you to experience forgiveness. I want to lift the burden off of you that you've been living with all this time, and that you're letting that define your life instead of letting me define your life. I'm ready to set you free. Do you want it? That's what he's offering. And if you've never received that, that's your next step right now. Now, if you have received that gift, let me ask you something that's a little more challenging. Would you describe your lifestyle and actions as reliably Christian? Would you describe your lifestyle and actions as reliably Christian? I didn't say perfectly. I said reliably. Are you faithful? Are you working out of the overflow from your relationship with Christ Jesus? So there's how he describes these saints. I mean, man, we're just in the first verse, right? Let's look at the second verse. The greeting, and it's a prayerful greeting at that. Paul gives this formal greeting, and this greeting actually is found in seven of Paul's letters. It's his kind of thing to do, and let me tell you why it's his thing. You see, in the ancient world, Clinton Arnold is a commentator that talked about this. The Greco-Roman way of writing letters, they would do exactly what Paul's done here. Who is it from? Who is it to? And here's a greeting. And in fact, they used in the Greek, they would use this word for greeting, right? That's how the next word you would expect. Well, Paul uses the word grace instead of greeting. And what's great about the Greek language that we're missing in the English is that grace and greeting in the Greek are basically the same word, the same root word. So he's got a little play on words going here, and then Paul makes that kind of his own little signature opening. And so why is that so important? Why does that matter? Because Paul's going to expound on this grace, how it's the unmerited gift of salvation from Jesus Christ to those who deserve condemnation instead. This word was at the heart of Paul's theology. It was at the heart of his worldview. Grace in the ancient world, you need to understand what their thinking was, so you can understand how we should think about it. Grace in the ancient world was when you receive something, a generous, benevolent gift from someone else who is of greater status than yourself. So if someone gave you something and they're of a higher rank than you, because yes, they had social classes back then, all right, in that culture, then that was grace. That was the picture. And this would be something, receiving something that's impossible for you to get on your own. And so Paul is talking about God's grace that is salvation of eternal life through Jesus Christ. Grace is God's generosity, and it encompasses not only the atonement and the forgiveness of our sins offered at the cross and tomb, but it's the opportunity, the strength, the wisdom, and the gift to live that holy life out. In other words, grace is both God's generous gift of life and the ongoing gift and power to live it out. Grace is God's gift of eternal life and his ongoing gift of power to live it out. And guess what? You and I don't deserve it. We don't deserve it, and we got to get that in our heads, in our hearts. That's what makes it grace. And in the ancient world, when you receive something like that, there was an expectation. There was an expected response when you receive that. The expected response was that you would show gratitude, thankfulness, and that you would honor the person who did this for you by going and telling others about it. That was the social norm of the day. In the South, we expect thank you notes, right? In their world, they expect you to go around the village and say, hey, did you hear what Nathan did for me? Man, he gave me this, my family, it made all the difference. Basically, you go around and honor Nathan by what he did for you, to the whole community. What has Christ done for you, and who have you told about it? Oops. Paul's greeting is actually a prayer. He's asking God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ that they would grant this grace as well as peace to the Ephesian churches. And the idea of peace in the New Testament is rich, it's multifaceted, and you got to look at every context of its usage. In fact, in Romans, Paul talks about that we have peace with God when we are justified through Jesus Christ. When we come to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus and we become a believer, a follower of Christ, we now have peace with God. We are no longer hostile to the things of God. Are you hostile to the things of God? I don't like this church thing. I don't have to pray. I can worship in a deer stand. Do you? When you're in the deer stand, do you actually worship? Oh, wait, they're all out in the deer stand. They didn't hear that. Okay, so Here's the point, though, is this idea that we are no longer hostile toward the things of God should now translate not only vertical but horizontally. And in the book of Ephesians, Paul's whole purpose of peace is that we are at peace with one another. There's disunity in their church, and he's wanting to find peace. And in chapter 2, 4, and 6, we see that idea repeated multiple times, and we'll get to that as we go through this series. The gift of grace and peace for which Paul prays comes from our God and Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. And as you read those words, that should challenge you to ask a very important question. Is God your Father? Is God your Father? Now, there's another sermon for another time about how we can have a bad understanding of what a father is. If you grew up with a lousy father or an absent father or whatever the case may be, the idea of a father may not sound all that appealing. But any failures you've seen on an earthly father, they do not exist in our heavenly Father. He is perfect. He is a good, good Father. And the question is he your Father at all? We can only be a child of God if we've been adopted in the family. Another thing our culture likes to say is that we're all children of God. No, you're not. Jesus very pointedly said to some Pharisees in John chapter 8, you're children of the devil. And if you knew my father, you'd be acting different. You're not in the family, dudes. Okay? That's the Jeff Smoke version of John 8. But here's the thing. We assume as Western Americans that everybody goes to heaven. We assume that everybody's a child of God. The Bible is very clear that is not the case. And the only way that you can have that is to have a relationship with our Father, and he adopts you as his child. Well, how does that happen? You see, children can't adopt themselves into the family. I don't know if you've ever noticed that. That's just not how it works. Kids don't go up to the courthouse, knock on the door, and say, hey, I'm going to adopt. They're going to adopt me, Judge. You need to make that happen. That's not how it works. And in the ancient world, that's not how it worked either. The father in the ancient world ideally was the one who made the decision if they were going to adopt a child or not. That was kind of his ideal role in the ancient world. And our father is an ideal father. The grace to which Paul has referred in this letter to is seen in God adopting people into his family. See, we couldn't get ourselves adopted. We had to have God do it for us. Paul wrote this in a little more detail in his letter to the Galatians. In chapter 3, starting in verse 26, he says, for in Christ Jesus you are all sons of God through faith. Notice he said, in Christ Jesus through faith. He didn't say you're all sons of God because you're human. For as many of you were baptized into Christ, have put on Christ. And then down in chapter 4, verse 3, it says, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. Because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son, and if a son, an heir through God. Paul's position is that people only in Christ, through faith, are children of God. Adoption was initiated by the Father, and he sent his son to do that for us. He redeemed us. Well, what did he redeem us from? In Galatians, he says he redeemed us from the elemental principles of this world, or the elemental spirits of this world, the things that the Ephesians were fighting against, the religious practices and the religious mumbo jumbo and all of that stuff. He said he's freed you from that. You are a slave to that. And in this text, he's going to say you're a slave to sin. But you know what? I've set you free from slavery. And I've made you one of my children. We no longer have to be a child of wrath, but we can be adopted children of God. And he redeemed us by sending his son. And in God's love, he gave his only begotten son. And whoever receives his son, John tells us, he gave the right to become a child of God. So you're not a child of God if you haven't received a son. Adoption is not free, by the way, speaking from experience. All right? Adoption is not free. You see, out in the ancient world, when you wanted to get a child who was slated to be a slave, you had to pay the price to free them from their slave owner. That's how it works. So if I wanted to adopt this child and they were owned by somebody who was going to raise them as a slave, I'd have to pay them money to get this child and adopt them. Think about that. What did Jesus do? He paid the price. He died on a cross to set us free and pay the price of our slavery to sin. He redeemed us. That's what the word means. The word redeem means to pay the penalty for us. So he died on a cross and took upon himself the wrath and judgment you and I deserve so we wouldn't have to. In that transaction, he paid the price of our sins. He took all of its legal consequences of our sin and nailed it to the cross and paid that debt. And that's how we're adopted into the family of God. Notice he also says that Jesus Christ is our Lord. Let me explain something to you. Do not call yourself a Christian if Jesus is only your Savior. Do not call yourself a Christian if he's only your Savior. Because he didn't write, Jesus Christ our Savior. Now, he is a Savior. But very often and more often you see Jesus Christ our Lord. He's the boss. If you claim to be a Christian, yet Christ is not directing your daily life and choices, you better question if you're a believer in the first place. Paul's prayer, his prayerful greeting here, makes it clear that grace and peace do not come through religious formulas, but it comes through authentic relationship. Do you have that authentic relationship with the Lord Jesus? Because if you don't, you're not going to experience the grace and peace. You're not at peace with God, and you're not at peace with other believers. The answer to Paul's prayerful greeting may be that some of us in here need to take a step of surrender to our Father's offer. And if you have received that offer and you've received that grace, then your life needs to reflect that reality. Again, grace is receiving something you couldn't obtain on your own by somebody who outranks you. And the response should be gratitude and telling others about it. David Da Silva, I'll end with this, wrote about it. He writes a book about first century culture. And he likens this whole cultural norm to what we receive in the gospel. He says, the receiving of favor must lead to return of gratitude, or else the beauty and nobility of the relationship is defaced, and he puts in parentheses, disgraced. D-I-S hyphen graced. Think about that. When you're offered that and you do not return the gratitude, you've hurt the relationship. As we grow in our appreciation of God's benevolence, we are thereby impelled to energize our commitment to make an appropriate response of gratitude to God. When the magnitude of God's generosity is considered, gratitude and its fruits must, out of necessity, fill our speech, attitudes, and actions. If you're a believer in Christ, are you really dependent on God's grace? Have you received it, first off, and are you dependent on it? And does that show up in your action, attitudes, and speech? We're gonna go into a time of response. Whatever God's laid on your heart, whatever he's doing in your heart right now, whatever your next step is, and that may be that, hey, you know what? I need to adjust my attitude. I need to adjust my actions. I need to adjust my speech. Or you know what I might need to do is surrender for the first time ever in my life that Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. And apart from him, I am done. And I need his help. Maybe that's you. Whatever that step is, you take it now.